Welcome to Season 3 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Josh Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former Secretary of Maryland's Health Department. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to the public health news of the day through informative interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes. Today, I speak with Professor Caleb Alexander and Kayte Anderson, a PhD candidate at the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. Our topic is their new paper addressing a long-standing question: are patients on medications that suppress their immune systems more vulnerable to severe cases of COVID? Let's listen. Caleb Alexander, Kayte Anderson, thank you so much for joining me to talk about this important question of what happens to people who are on immunosuppressive medications when they get COVID-19. We've gotten a lot of questions about this at our email address, publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. Why did you study this question? Maybe I'll start with you, Professor Alexander.
Well, thanks for having us and giving us the opportunity to share the results of our work. We were interested in looking at the outcome of individuals taking chronic immunosuppressive medicines because going into the pandemic, there was enormous concern that these individuals may be at heightened risk for more severe COVID outcomes. On the other hand, we know that part of the pathogenesis of COVID infection is often a hyperinflammatory response and an immune system that's kicked into overdrive. And so prior to our doing this work, there was reason to believe both that individuals taking these medicines, such as prednisone or tacrolimus or mycophenolate, there was reason to believe on the one hand that they might have more severe or worse COVID outcomes, and on the other hand, that they might actually have better COVID outcomes.
Got it. Kayte Anderson, what are some of the conditions that people take these medicines for?
So most often we saw them used for people who have had a solid organ transplant to prevent them from rejecting that organ after they were transplanted. And we also saw some autoimmune condition medications, such as the TNF inhibitors that some people with rheumatologic conditions need.
And those patients are pretty anxious about what might happen if they were to get COVID.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure.
Maybe I'll turn back to you, Caleb. What did you do to assess this question?
Well, we were fortunate that we were able to use a database, a patient registry containing longitudinal electronic health record information that was assembled by investigators, scientists, and other team members at Johns Hopkins. And so we were able to use this registry of individuals with COVID infection to examine whether or not relatively short-term outcomes, things such as length of hospital stay, requirement for mechanical ventilation, or death, say, within 30 days of hospitalization or COVID infection, we were able to look at these outcomes among a fairly large and comprehensive cohort of individuals with COVID infection, some of whom were exposed to these medicines and others who were not.
So you're trying to figure out whether being on immunosuppressive medicine makes the COVID worse, basically. And what I understand you saying is that you're comparing people who were not taking those medicines with the people who were taking those medicines to see if there's some big differences that you can spot. Is that fair?
Yeah, that's exactly right.
All right. So, Kayte Anderson, I'm going to turn to you for the results. What did you find when you actually did this, knowing that going in, someone could make an argument that it would be worse and someone could make an argument that it might be better? What did you find?
We found neither. So we found that there was no increase or decrease in risk of the need for invasive ventilation, the length of hospital stay, or the risk of death. And this was a really important finding, and we were very careful in the analyses to make sure that we accounted for age and sex and some of the health conditions that people had before they came into the hospital, because we know that those could affect people's risk as well. And even when we did the best job statistically we could, we still found no increased risk.
And so it might not matter for somebody's course of COVID whether or not they're on some pretty serious immunosuppressive drugs. Is that what you're saying?
That's what we have found, and that's what others have found as well.
Tell me more about what others have found.
Other groups have found, similar to us in single-site centers, that there's no increased risk. And this is something that we're looking at really carefully now using a national data set. So we have many more patients, and we're able to be maybe more precise in our estimates, but also look at some specific classes of medications to see if within the grouping of immunosuppressive, if any of them act differently than the others.
Were there any signals that that might be the case or any suspicions you have?
We have some indication that one of the medications used in solid organ transplant might be protective. That's work that's ongoing, and we're working to untangle that association now. And then we also know that dexamethasone is currently the only evidence-based therapy that reduces the risk of death in hospital, and that's an immunosuppressive medication as well.
I see. So, Caleb, could you talk a little bit about how it might be the case that some of these immunosuppressives may actually be protective for people? What's the little bit more about the logic there?
Yeah, well, it's a great query. And I do want to say about dexamethasone, there is good evidence to support the use of dexamethasone among individuals with active COVID infection. That's different than the sort of exposures that we were looking at in our study, because in our study, we were looking at people who were maintained chronically on an immunosuppressive medicine, whether a steroid or something else. But one of the reasons that these products may not pose greater risk to individuals is that, as I mentioned earlier, that part of the pathogenesis of COVID or severe COVID in many individuals is a hyperinflammatory response, and where the immune system is really kicked into overdrive. And so it's possible that the maintenance of individuals on chronic immunosuppressive medicines up until the time of COVID infection could theoretically provide some protection of individuals during the course of their COVID infection. But there's a lot more work that needs to be done. You know, it's sort of a double-edged sword. On the one hand, we have enormous amounts of science being generated every day, and our study makes a small contribution, but there are also many, many unanswered questions regarding the role of these medicines in either decreasing the likelihood of severe disease or, in some cases, serving as a treatment for people who are actively infected.
Got it. Kayte, is there anything that we can conclude from the study about the underlying conditions and their relationship with severity of COVID, or is it really primarily about the medications?
We focused on medications in this study.
But I would say many people that have immunosuppressive conditions don't just have one condition, and many may also be have advanced age or obesity or other conditions that pose risks. So, you know, I've received many questions since our study about what does the study say about people that have cancer or that have HIV or that have had a solid organ transplant. And I've tried to highlight that in our case, we were really focusing on the medications themselves. We did all we could to increase the comparability of the groups that we examined, those on chronic immunosuppressive medicines and their counterparts. But ours was not really a study of individuals, for example, with cancer per se, but rather a focus on these types of medicines.
So for patients with these conditions who might be taking these medicines, one thing to know is that doesn't necessarily mean you're going to have a worse course. On the other hand, COVID can still be such a serious disease. Not getting a worse course could mean the same chance of a very severe outcome. On the other hand, vaccination is still recommended for people in these groups. Isn't that right, Dr. Alexander?
It is. It is. And we have yet to learn whether individuals will produce as robust an immune response who are vaccinated. And I think there's certainly reason for some concern that the benefit of immunization may be somewhat attenuated, but there are studies underway to figure that out. And certainly one message for individuals who they themselves or the loved ones may be taking these medicines is don't stop them, don't summarily stop them. And our study suggests that they need not be stopped even with the clinician's input in order to affect COVID outcomes, because it appears again that individuals on these medicines do just as well as their counterparts if they get COVID infection.
Well, it's so important to get data for particular patient populations. And this is a group of people who have been extremely on edge during the pandemic, wondering whether their immune system may pose an extra risk. Kayte, I know you are a PhD student now, PhD candidate at Johns Hopkins. Is this an area that you intend to do further research in?
It is. This is a really interesting experience for me because I had completely other plans for my PhD in terms of the medications that we were going to focus on, and just the opportunity and the questions and the importance of the questions. I felt like we're throwing myself into full time, and I've had tremendous support from my advisors for that change as well. And I think it's a really important question to continue to untangle.
It definitely is. And there are a lot of people who appreciate that you made that decision. So thank you for joining me. Thank you as well, Caleb. And we really appreciate having you on Public Health On Call.
Thanks very much.
Thanks for having us.
Public Health On Call is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmond. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, C.N. Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo and Neiman Outlin. Social media support from Brenda Hageter, Grace Holes Fernandez, and Caroline Wong. Thank you for listening.